This is immune-based therapy, autologous transplant, and it won't work. It will be disappointing. So remember this, no inflammation, no response, and you won't panic. Okay. We'll go into a little more details. This is our, we use different regimens, and this is the regimen we've settled on that works best in our hands for transplant for multiple sclerosis. I know in Europe we use beam, and you know, I don't have any experience with beam. I think that's all great, but in our hands, this is the one that, that works the best. It is non-myeloablative. We don't have to give the stem cells, but the stem cells shorten the duration of cytopenia. And it's 200 milligrams of cytotoxin, 200 milligrams per kilogram, and a total of 6 of RAS, ATG, or thymoglobulin. And we do not see CD34s like the peripheral blood cells. So I'm going to show you the initial data leading up to the randomized trial in 151 patients that we reported in 2015, January 2015, in the Journal of the American Medical Association, which today is the largest single center group of patients reported, and they were, of course, non-randomized. We had no mortality, overall survival, 99.3%. One patient died of hypertension, had poorly controlled hypertension when the patient came to us and continued to not be compliant with medications. And it just stresses that you shouldn't really consider these options for patients that have other medical problems, especially if you're doing it on a study. Being outside a study, you have to consider the other medical risks that patients have before doing this procedure. We, in those 150 patients, had no opportunistic infections. In fact, unlike the European JC guidelines, we don't even check for Epstein-Barr virus. It's just really never been a problem. What we did have post-transplant is 6% hypothyroidism. So be prepared for that. Whenever they come back 6 months in yearly, we always check T3, T4, TSH, that is thyroid function, and we can pick it up preemptively. But it turns out even MS patients that get beta serum have 7% hyperthyroidism. And in these 150 patients, 7% of the patients that have come to us already have hyperthyroidism. So I don't really think this is a result of our regimen. I just think thyroid dysfunction runs with multiple sclerosis hand in hand. We did, however, have 2% ITP, and so that's the one late effect that, of course, always concerns me, and we are very careful to advise patients if they notice any easy bruising, to immediately get a CBC and let us know. It responds very quickly to IV oxygen steroids, if not a few doses of rituxan, and it goes away. But it always worries me that someone would ignore easy bruising and have a serious bleed. And it's one of the things we want to eliminate in future regimens is that risk of ITP. Of course, there's risk of infertility that's age dependent, that they're always informed about. So this is what we look at. These are traditional outcome parameters used by neurologists in pharmaceutical trials for MS. These are neurologic disability scales, the EDSS, extended disability status scale, NRS, neurologic rating scale. The 9-hole peg test is a measure of upper extremity coordination and function. ASAP is a cognitive assay based on the addition test. 25-foot walk, and of course we have to do a quality of life questionnaire, an MRI to follow burden of disease in the brain. And if in that JAMA paper in these 150 patients, what we reported is that if you look at the median EDSS before stem cell transplant in red, it was 4, and it markedly improved after the procedure. You can see that the p-values are highly significant at all time points after the procedure. And that's really never been seen in any drug company trials. So basically, all drug company trials are based on slowing progression, not reversing progression. And nobody's ever seen a one-point improvement. The best they've ever had is with Medtrada, one of the most recent drugs, MSK1 and MSK2. In Lancet, where they had a 0.6 improvement in the study group, here we've had better than 1. So that has never been seen in all the other drugs. They don't even see that 0.6. Depending where you are in the EDSS scale, you need at least a 1-point change to be outside the variability of the assessment by the neurologist, because it can vary at the time of day, and the patient's evaluated later in the fatigue, it's the EDS, it's worse. So this is a very significant improvement, never seen before. If we look at coordination, manual kick test, left hand or right hand, it didn't matter. It's just taking things out of poles and putting them back in, like you can do your left or right hand. It markedly improves in the seconds, showing that there is marked improvement after the procedure of coordination, cognitive function, ASAP, again, it's a pace, auditory serial repetition test, you give two numbers, you have to add them together, you give them another number, and you have to remember the number before you get back to that number. So in fact, some patients can get pretty upset with it and just throw the machine off the table. You can see that they do improve after the procedure. Now this isn't randomized, so you could say, well, it's just a learning function, they're getting better with time and doing it. They only do a pre-transplant 6 months, 1 year, and yearly, but you could make that argument. Nevertheless, it improves, and actually, it's, we have the 2 second also improved. Do both 3 and 2 seconds to answer, and these are the percent correct. But patients have always said to me, these inflammatory, where you want to treat inflammatory MS, that this cloud in their consciousness lifts over the possible. They can make it through, and it's very important for highly performing professionals, such as lawyers or physicians, some of whom have taken through the procedure, and they were having extensive difficulty performing their daily activities at work, trying to hide it from colleagues, and it suddenly lifted and they can think straight again. And that happens before they leave the hospital. If we look at the SF36, you can see before transplant it's in red here, after transplant results in blue, those p values are highly significant. And what's important about this, if you look at all the drug company trials, they don't even report quality of life. Even in the recent CAMPATH studies, MS-CARE-1 and MS-CARE-2, they don't report quality of life, because every trials. In the papers that they publish the results, they don't report quality of life. So I searched the literature carefully, and when they looked at a large number of combined studies of PASTAVRI, they had a 2-point improvement in was the mental health score. And so they said it improves quality of life. But that was a statistical improvement in a large number of people. It wasn't clinically relevant. And that's because you need around a 5-point change for the patient to feel the difference in the quality of life. And as you can see here, we have about an 18-point change. So this has never been seen before. In fact, most studies don't report quality of life as with the pharmacologic drug therapy for MS. And if we look at relapse-free survival, we do get relapses. In 5 years, about 20% relapse, but again, after one treatment, no further treatment, 80% did not relapse. Compared to drug therapy, where you just stay on continued drugs for an extended period of time. So that looks pretty good. Progression-free survival, there's no increase in permanent neurologic disability in the majority of patients. And actually, the results would be better if they were all relapsing, admitting about 20 of the patients were early secondary progressive. Again, I say don't do non-inflammatory disease, don't do late secondary progressive. We won't do it. Sometimes people are going this early phase of secondary progressive and they exploit your heart strings, they eventually do it. And sometimes you kind of help and sometimes you don't. But those 20 people contaminated this curve that I think without them would be even better. And I want to show you that here. Details are important. Here's a change in EDSS, whether they were relapsed remitting or secondary progressive. In these 150 patients, again, about 130 were relapsed remitting and about 20 were secondary progressive. And so you can see in these secondary progressive in red, the EDSS really changed, whereas it improved, that is, it got less. But even more than 1 point, which is pretty much unheard of in drug company trials, which are focused on relapsed remitting, not early secondary progressive. Within this group, about half got better of the secondary progressives, about half got better, and about half didn't, so together they look the same. But again, that's why I say no inflammation, no response, avoid the secondary progressives. And if we looked at age, we actually saw independent of age, they got better. So of course, these are the young people, 18 to 25, really hard to improve, but even when we looked at our oldest patient, we did 40, you can see they got better, that is the EDSS decreased with time. Not quite as much, but they got better. And I actually didn't put this slide in the general location because I'm afraid people will say, oh, good, you know, we'll do 50-year-olds. But what you have to realize, the older you are, the more likely you're progressive, not inflammatory. So 90% of patients at onset are relapsing remitting, but by the age of 40, only about 40% are relapsing remitting. So you can take old people, it's older, older individuals, if they have inflammatory disease, but be careful, because most likely they don't. So make sure you understand the difference between active inflammatory relapse remitting versus progressive disease. Most old patients will not respond like this. If you are truly getting those few that still have active inflammatory disease, however, they still respond well. Important for MS, and this is unusual for hematologists doing transplants, is that during transplant, if they get a fever, long-term follow-up. So here's ones with sustained fevers or without, you know, no fever over 38. Here's fevers greater than 39. That's at least 10 fevers over 24 hours greater than 39. And you can see once we look at 2 years, 3 years out, they're doing worse. The EDSS is increasing. And so when we get fevers now, we block the fever immediately with some methyl. And in transplant for cancers and leukemias, you won't do that. You're going to let them have a fever. You're going to keep looking for a source, do CT scans, and all kinds of things. But that's the wrong thing to do in this subset of patients. So what we found in these MS patients is the fever's really due to the rabbit ATG, and it usually occurs between day 0 and 6. And we have a poster here, if you want to look at it after this session, about the fever. It's B013, I think. And the most common day of the fever is day plus one. But when they get the fever, they have pseudoflares of their MS. They just can't even move some of them. And by the way, oh, the MS is flaring, we do an MRI in the brain. Don't do any of that. Give them sodium ethyl. But be careful. We already, as soon as they're doing printing, we start broad spectrum, 17 or so. If they get a fever, we add vancomycin, we draw cultures, we get urine for Legionella. Give chest x-ray, but we give solumetrol, and you'll see as soon as they get it 3 hours later, they're on walking, doing great, and they look like someone who's gone from where they couldn't move, getting a pseudoflare, and that's related to just walking and smiling. So it's very important to do that, not only to avoid that problem in the hospital acutely, but the late outcome of neuronal damage from that. So neurons that are not covered by myelin seem to be more susceptible to oxidative stress or damage from fever, and you get an accelerated axonal damage later in the disease. Now, what I want to show you, and I showed this in the opening ceremony, is the native, no evidence of the disease. And native means that there's no clinical relapses. There's no progression in neurologic disability, and there's no new lesions on MRI. And so if we look over 5 years at our JAMA paper with 151 patients here, this is the result of the data, but we can compare that to the Swedish study where Dr. Berman had very similar results in high-use cytoxin ATG. Dr. Berman initially started with beam ATG, switched to cytoxin ATG, so about 20 patients are beam, 20 are cytoxin ATG. He comes and admits in his paper that there's no difference in outcome between the two. And then you can look at the Seattle Pulse study where they used beam on all the patients, 25 of them, and that's their results. The interesting thing is, despite the differences in regimen, despite the fact that these three centers were not connected in their individual reports, Sweden, Chicago, Seattle, we had very similar data. In fact, in 4 years, we had identical data. But if you look at the drug company results, and drug companies usually report 1 or 2 years, not longer, so after 2 years you tend not to see data out here, but you can see whether it's natalizumab or tocilizumab, one of the newest drugs, or Lentrada, alemtuzumab, we have a much lower data. And in fact, what I want you to focus on, I mentioned this in the open ceremony, is if opening ceremonies, if you look at 4 years, you can see that the NADA It is about 18% that is no evidence of disease activity. This is from the Klein cohort at Harvard, where they followed 216 patients for 7 years to look, and they would treat them like they normally would, different drugs, whatever is considered best by the neurologist at the time. And they're on continued drug therapy. But you can see by 7 years of 216 patients, only 17 had no evidence of disease activity. And in 4 years, you can see it's only about 18%. Compare that to transplant. You can see all three studies, not randomized, but all three shows 70% negative. So it seems to be significantly different. And the important part about this data is you can use it. Your statisticians can figure out the number of patients for a randomized trial to achieve significance. Because there is such a separation out here between these two curves, you can do a relatively small number of patients, not the 150, 200 each arm that most studies do, if this data is correct. On the other hand, if you do your randomized trial, you don't get this kind of data here or this kind of data down here, something's wrong, perhaps, with differences in the selection of patient populations between these studies and these studies. So obviously you have to do a randomized trial, and that's what we did. And that randomized trial is completed. We call it MIST, Multiple Sclerosis International Stem Cell Transplant Trial. Of course, it was in Chicago, because that's also in Sheffield. The two guys in the University of Sheffield, Dr. John Snowden, who you all know, and Basil Schrock, the neurologist. And in Sweden, at the University of Uppsala, is Joachim Berman. The University of São Paulo, or UPSI, is Carolina Oliveira. In any event, the study has been completed. Importantly, the neurologist that did the evaluating, not the treating neurologist with standard drug therapy, but the evaluating neurologist was blinded, so he didn't know which arm the patient was on. Now, you can't blind a patient. It's just a reality. But you can blind the evaluating neurologist. So here's the kind of the outline of the trial, is that there were 110 patients, and our primary endpoint for failure was EDSS, that is neurologic disability. And the reason we chose that is that's the failure endpoint for most MS studies. It's not NAGA, it's EDSS. So we said if your EDSS increased for 1 point and was sustained for at least 6 months, so it wasn't just an acute attack, but a sustained increase in EDSS for 6 months, because most acute attacks by 6 to 8 weeks, certainly by 3 months, they're gone, they've resolved. So if it's sustained for at least 6 months after at least 1 year on standard therapy, that would be a failure. We had 110 patients. We selected relapsing remitting. The EDS scale, disability scale, goes from 0, which is normal, to 10, which is dead. So it's kind of here a little bit in the mid-range, with 2 relapses in the prior year, so that's highly active MS. And these are confirmed relapses, not, I felt a little numb, these are confirmed relapses in the last year, despite at least frontline therapy, and then they were randomized to either continued disease-modifying therapy, DMT, disease-modifying therapy, which are the standard drugs out there, versus transplant. And it actually 55 in each arm. Disease-modifying therapy, the most common drug chosen was Bisabri or natalizumab, which is a whole variety of drugs there, they're all FDA approved. The number adds up more than 55 because people could, the neurologists would do what they do in real life. They would change medications based on toxicity or effect or whatever. And some of the patients, although these aren't FDA approved, they're standard drugs used for really aggressive MS, got IV cyclophosphamide, rituximab, previously really an anti-B cell antibody like rituximab. So they got rituximab. IVIG is used for very aggressive MS, so is plasmapheresis. And of course, many of them ended up getting steroids as well. But importantly, they remained on these drugs. We did a transplant and then no further therapy. And we had 4 in the disease-modifying therapy that we had to withdraw because they went and got transplants somewhere else. 2 at the time of randomization, despite carefully explaining, that you have to stay with this, but they didn't. And 2 got tired of having new lesions, having attacks, but not having 1 point increase in EDSS, and they left us got transplants in Mexico or Russia. So we had 51 down here. Now, importantly, if after at least 1 year their EDSS had increased 1 point, they could cross over to transplant. And that was a saving grace that everybody's really in control of. Here we had three withdrawn from the transplant arm, two because at the time they enrolled, they really sent their rest, and then one had a pre-before started treatment, had repeated infections, so they decided not to take the patient to transplant. The reason for those repeated infections, we kind of didn't know. So that's what happened, and again, there were no deaths, no grade 4 toxicity, one episode of a back brain yet, unassociated with any blood pressure changes and positive in only one culture, no early or late opportunistic infections, importantly, no CD, PCD, PML, that PML is unique and a horrible complication, JC virus infection in MS patients, and Epstein-Barr virus, none of that. If we look at the primary endpoint, time to EDSS failure, sustained increasing disability by at least 1 point, between the transplant arm, which is this arm, versus continued DMARD therapy, it's highly significantly different. And this was determined by blinded neurologists. So that's very significant. Now, the first year they couldn't fail by definition. Nobody can cross over, nobody can fail in the first year. You have to at least have one more year of continued growth therapy before you can call that failure, and you needed at least a 6 month interval showing that the EDSS had increased. But basically, this kind of looks like a straight line, put it all together here. Here's the line here. So this was highly significant, as you can see the p-value there. But within the first year, we can compare a lot of different things between the two arms. After the first year, bad actors are dropping out, transplant, you really can't. But within that first year, if we looked at what happened to the EDSS, in the drug arm, just kept getting worse, the higher number is worse. And look at the, because they were randomized, they started at the same point. In the transplant arm, they got better. If we looked at NRS, neurologic rating scale, it's another disability scale, it's a Scripps NRS, I actually like better than EDSS, but nevertheless, EDSS is more traditional. But the transplant group in this scale, the higher the number, the better, they got much better. In the control arm, they got worse, that is continued drug therapy. And if we look at nine-fold PEC test, which is a measure of coordination and dexterity of your upper extremities, you can see the transplant group got much better, the time to do it decreased, whereas the drug therapy group got worse. And we could have done that in virtually all of the different outcome parameters we looked at. It showed already a significant difference by the end of 1 year. And so we also looked at MRI T2 lesion volume in centimeters cubed from baseline in the transplant versus continued drug therapy. And you can see here in continued drug therapy, lesion burden in the brain continues to increase. It increased actually 34% from 100, initially 100% to 134%. And the people that got transplant, despite the fact there's no further therapy after transplant, it continued to improve over time. The lesion burden in the brain decreased, and that's kind of not seen in drug trials. And so we had this checked multiple times by neurologists that read these type of MRIs, Claudia Nelson, who's at the University of Texas, not the University of Minnesota, did these in a double-check this in a blinded fashion, because she herself didn't believe it at first when we showed her the data, but she confirmed it, that these are the results we're getting. And so now, if we look at NADA, between the two arms, NADA means no evidence of disease activity, that is, no relapses, no progression in the EDSS, no new or enlarging or enhancing lesions on the MRI. And you can see that's even much more significant. Here's the drug arm, here's the transplant arm. And remember I said in the non-randomized study, if you look at 4 years, in that non-randomized trial, the drugs were about 18% here, 4 years it's about 5%. And in the three relapse remitting studies I showed from Sweden, from Seattle, from us in Chicago, it was about 70%. But actually at 4 years here, it's much better. You know, it's a little better than 80%. So it actually did hold up, and it's even better. Why would it be even better? It's because in this study, we took highly active MS, a lot of relapses. Remember, no inflammation, no response. The more inflammation, the better the response. In the non-randomized, you know, there were several patients that were not as active, they were still relapsing on anyone and not active. But these results ended up being even better and highly significant. Now, here's where we are today with the study. We're a median of 3 years, or I think a mean of 3.5 years. And so far, the 51 and DMARDs, 20 have crossed. We only have, on the 51 and DMARDs, 31 have failed and crossed over to transplant. So initially 52 went to transplant. With those that have crossed over, we now have 83 that have gone to transplant. 20 remain on DMARDs. And although this study is for 5 years, so these are the data today, meaning of 3 years and 5 year follow-up. But actually, two patients after 5 years crossed over. So this would be down to 18. But we're only reporting 5 year follow-up. So currently this is where we are. And if we look at these 83 patients that got transplant, ones that crossed over and the ones that initially went to transplant, how they're all doing, what you can see is that the EDSS had a marked improvement, 4.1, and then stayed about the same. An improvement of 1.5 points, which is unheard of in any narcotic trial. And if we look at these 83 patients at their T2 lesion volume, remember I showed the difference on the control arm is the lesion volume of the brain is going up, the transplant is going down. So let's look over 5 years in these 83 patients, what's happened to T2 lesion volume. And this is it. It just keeps kind of improving, reaching an asymptote out here in 5 years, but even better from 3 to 4 years, shrinking of the lesions on MRI. Again, this is pretty much unheard of in studies for clinical studies for MS, and these are people who are on no treatment afterwards. So it makes sense that quality of life improves. You get better and get off drugs with all their side effects. So of course quality of life improves. And as I said, the drug company trials don't even mention quality of life. So this is my team at Northwestern. This is in front of our law school. I'm in the back here, and actually I have three of my team here today, Bailey, Raven, Gary, and Kim. And they'll be at the poster session, so if you don't believe what I told you, feel free to ask them. And so where do we go from here? I have 2 minutes to tell you. And where do we go after MIST? What comes after our MIST protocol? Well, we want to do a cost analysis of transplant versus DMARDs. And we're doing a new trial, MOST, maximizing the outcome of stem cell transplant. See if we can do even better. But the reason I want to do a cost analysis, if this was reported in neurology in 2015, but these are 2013 costs. So that's several years ago, and I'm sure they're much more expensive. But these are American US dollars in America, each of these drugs. It's ridiculous. And that's just the drug. If they have to be infused, like Tysabri, that's not the infusion cost. That's not MRI cost. That's not the neurologist cost. And that's no drug or lab draw monitoring cost. So, and those are $2,013, so I would imagine be a lot more now. But what they estimated in this paper is that to prevent one relapse using drugs, it costs $80,000. Now, in this paper, they didn't have Lentrada, alemtuzumab, but alemtuzumab in America is $156,000 for the first year. And that's just the drug, not infusion, not position, not MRI, not blood draw or anything. So I think the cost analysis is warranted. This could be a case of a win-win, where we save money for insurance, we save money for public health care, and the patients get better. Of course, you always have to put the caveat. Any aggressive therapy like this is also something you have to respect, be careful with. You can never, ever do this without a death. I always tell patients, expect 0.5% mortality or don't do it. I'm always amazed how patients are very much willing to accept that. So, and you want to do it in a center that's experienced and understands this disease and this treatment and selection of these patients. But this is very powerful therapy, anything very powerful, you have this judiciously in its use. And here we are in Chicago. So thank you.